Hey ghouls and gals, welcome back to another weekly reading vlog. So it is Tuesday, October 6th. It seems very crazy to me that it's already the 6th. I feel like just once we hit October, the year just flies. So because it is the beginning of new month, I did get a couple of bookish boxes. So I thought I would do a little bit of a unboxing for you guys. I have the Unplugged Book Box and then also my Book of the Month box. It's gonna be pretty fast and they're not sponsored or anything like that. So all opinions are my own and quite honestly, just because they are pretty expensive. I love the idea of book boxes in theory, but the reason why the only reoccurring book box subscription that I do have is Book of the Month is because I do like choosing the books I'm getting. I just don't really like that mystery aspect of it because I just feel like for some months you might not enjoy any of the products, or some months you might like them all. So I just don't like the mystery aspect about it. But I did want to get Unplugged's October book box because it was horror themed, and I had a feeling based on some of the hints of the items that I would love a lot of the items. So this is a one-time thing for me, at least for right now. I did get the adult box because I primarily read adult fiction. And full disclaimer, I did already like open this up and look inside it. But I thought I would give a little rundown because I was pretty impressed with most of the things in the box. There are like a couple of things that I just don't really see myself using. Like there's this really nice pillowcase and it has the Night Circus quote on it. I did not actually really like the Night Circus. I do like the vibes of this though. And I also don't have any like pillows to fit that. So I'm probably going to save this and re-gift it. Probably just give it to like my little sister because she loves quotes. She's very big into things that have quotes. She makes little inspirational signs and puts them all over her room. So I think she would really like this. And I think if you like the Night Circus, I think it's a cool pillowcase. I just don't, so that's why I'm not going to be using the pillowcase. But the design is very pretty and I do like the artwork. I am just not a fan of this book. The next thing in the box is Edgar Allan Poe inspired, which is exciting because I do like Poe's work. And it's from The Telltale Heart, and it is the beating of his hideous heart is the little saying on this, and it's a little keepsake box. It's pretty shallow, so you can't fit a ton of stuff in it, but I think this would be really good for like bookmarks or like any sort of like paper memento. So I might keep it on our bookshelf downstairs, which has like movies and games on it as well, on our horror shelf, and I might put like ticket stubs, stuff like that in there. So small little paper things. It is a pretty simple design, which I do really like. I like that more minimalistic thing. When it's on the side, it just looks like wood. So that's nice. And then it does have some more script. I don't know if you can see it in black in the background. The next item in the box, based on the hints, I thought it was going to be a face mask, which I was excited about because you can never have too many reusable face masks. But it is a gaiter, and I don't wear gaiters because I think they look a little bit ridiculous. And other than that, they just don't work as well as masks. So I was kind of bummed because I do actually love most of the books on here, actually. I think pretty much all of the books on here are horror books that I have enjoyed. But I figured out the perfect use for this, and it actually works perfectly as a bandana for my dog. I'll insert footage here. So actually, this is one of my favorite items just because my dog looks super cute in it. And it just has a bunch of traditional gothic literature. So we've got Frankenstein, Dracula, Haunting of Hill House, Interview with the Vampire, some Stephen King in there as well. I do wish it would have been a mask instead of a gaiter. I don't even know if that's how you pronounce it, but I'm pretty sure that's how it's like Gaiter, I think. But this works perfectly as a dog bandana, so I cannot complain. I know that's not the purpose, but I'm a crazy dog lady, apparently. The next item we have is very small, so I don't know if you'll be able to see it, but it's Freddy's Claw Repair Cuticle Cream. So I do love Nightmare on Elm Street, so it's really cool to see that fandom in a box. And this is super practical, so I'm very excited to actually use this. I am a nail biter. I have been since pretty much as long as I've had nails to bite, and my cuticles definitely have a tendency to get a little busted, so I actually will use this, so that's exciting. And it just kind of smells like lemon, I think. Something citrusy and fresh. So this is definitely nice. I do like getting little beauty things like this because I would never buy a cuticle cream, but I would definitely use one as an adult. I feel like there are a lot of things that you probably should buy or you probably want to buy, but they're not exciting to spend your money on, so you never do. Like, I've recently started really investing in like SPF and skincare and all of that, and it's not fun to spend a lot of money on just because like washing your face and sunscreen and stuff like that is not fun to buy, but you probably should. You probably don't need cuticle cream, but I'm gonna guess that it helps, so I am gonna use it, so that's really nice. So the next item that we have is this lovely little Hocus Pocus bath bomb. Apparently there's a surprise inside. I don't know what that is because it is like pretty small, but that'll be exciting. I'll probably use this closer to Halloween. So I'm actually really excited about this as well because I'm a fiend for Lush bath bombs and they're pretty pricey. And this is a little thrifty hack here. Just cut them in half. They work the same and you can get two baths out of one bath bomb. But I'm excited to get another bath bomb because definitely as the weather gets colder, baths become more and more appealing. So I'm very excited to use this product. Now the next two products are like my favorite products other than the book in the box, and a large part of why I got this box in the first place, not gonna lie. So we have this little enamel pin of Georgie and the Red Balloon. It is one of my favorite books, and this is another thing. I would never buy an enamel pin for myself. I don't actually have any enamel pins. I think I have like some pins from childhood, but I think this one is really nice, really simplistic, and this is such like a big favorite fandom of mine. It's one of my favorite books, favorite movies, so I will be using this. I don't know if I'm gonna put it on like a bag or maybe a jacket. I just really love how simplistic this is. There's not a lot of marketing on it. It just has that iconic raincoat and red balloon. So it's one of those if you know things. It's not like in your face bookish merch. It's just more of a little nod to that franchise, which is really cool. And then the final non-book item, which I'm so excited about, we have a candle, and not just any candle, but a Pennywise inspired candle. So this is the Pennywise or We All Float Down Here candle, and it supposedly smells like rainy afternoons and carnival candy fear, which is incredible. The inside is really cute as well. It has that red balloon, and the wick is actually, if you lift up the balloon's string, that is the wick of the candle, which is really cool. And it has some red glitter in there as well. It does have like a taffy, buttery, caramel corn sort of smell. I almost don't want to burn it just because it's so cute. I will be keeping the tin after I finish burning the candle because it is pretty cute packaging. It says we all float down here. So I'll either put it on like my Stephen King shelf or again downstairs, like where all of our horror movies are. This is very sweet smelling. I'm really excited. I do actually like this scent. I would have liked it either way because it's a really cute candle and I love the franchise that it comes from, but it is a benefit. I love super sweet smells. That is the most polarizing, I think, smell in here is the candle. The rest of the objects that smelled in here were very clean and citrusy, but in a very nice neutral way, which would smell good, and I think anyone would like that. That candle's super sweet, which I love, but I'm guessing probably not everyone does. And then we have a little note from the author and then the book itself, which I was very excited about, and one of the reasons why I ordered the box because I did want to pick up this book anyway. And I figured why not get it and then just support a bunch of small businesses by getting little bookish things as well. That is gonna be The Hollow Places by T. Kingfisher. I read her last book last year. And it was called The Twisted Ones. I believe it was folklore horror, and it was written really well. I had a lot of fun with it. And I'm really excited to pick this one up. And this is about a woman who works in a very extraordinary museum. This museum is the Glory to God Museum of Natural Wonders, Curiosities, and Taxidermy. And Kara, who's our protagonist, finds a mysterious hole in the drywall, and that leads to a different place. So it's like portal magic horror, which I really love. And I've already read something from this author, and I really enjoyed the writing style. So I'm definitely going to try and read this in October because The Twisted Ones was so atmospheric, and I read it in like late November, and it was a very perfect read for that time in the season. This one feels like it also is going to have kind of that late autumn feel. So I'm hoping to get to this by the end of October, but if not in November. And it's like the most perfect floppy paperback, which I'm really excited about. So that is my first unplugged book unboxing. So, I mean, my overall takeaways, all of the items, even the ones that I didn't personally find a use for, I think they're done very well. You can tell they're done by small businesses. They definitely feel like homemade crafts, which is really cool. I know I'm not the only one who's really trying to support small businesses, And book boxes do seem to be a really great way to do that all the way around. I would be lying if I said that all of the items were 10 out of 10s for me. Obviously, I think you can tell by the way that I kind of went through them. I kind of went through the ones that I didn't like as much to my favorite items. But honestly, if I consider just buying the book, the candle, the enamel pin, and the bath bomb, which are items that I probably would have bought on my own, the price of the box is still a lot less than what all those would be individually. So I do think it is a good price. And even the items that weren't like the best fit for me, there's really only one that I don't see myself using, and it's still really good quality. Like I said, I don't really have a budget to buy book boxes every single month, but I really enjoyed getting this special little spooky themed treat around the holidays. Holidays being Halloween for me is my favorite holiday, just as like an extra little treat to kind of get in the Halloween spirit, just because Halloween and everything surrounding fall is going to look a whole lot different this year. Just because I'm normally doing so many things like going into haunted houses, going to orchards, corn mazes, all of that things, I think that's just gonna be really impacted by COVID this year. So I really wanted to get myself something a little seasonal to really get me in the spirit. I really do like Unplug's whole book mission, so I definitely probably will order from them again. A good and a bad thing about the service is that I don't focus on a specific genre of books. So this one I was really excited about because it was a horror book. I know, I think last month it was a romance, which I am not interested in, so that would be something that I would have to kind of check the spoiler clues before ordering, just to make sure that the book would be something that I like. Overall, I am pretty impressed with the purchase, and I can't wait especially to read that book. And especially the It-themed things are really awesome, and I'm really happy to have them. Now moving on to book of the month. This is exciting, because not only am I super excited about the books that I have in here, probably the most excited I've been for a book of the month box this year, but I also completed their reading challenge, which means I got a special little surprise as well. So how part of their program works is if you read 12 of their books in a year, and you review them and mark them as read on their website, then you get a candle when you reach that 12 book mark. I am a maniac, and I unfortunately cannot limit myself to just one pick a month, so I did already hit that 12 books read. And I believe for the challenge you also have to read 4 different genres and 3 debuts, I think, which is pretty easy when it comes to book of the month, because they do a bunch of different genres and they focus on primarily debut authors. So I got this little candle. It's a freebie from Anecdote Candles. I do appreciate the effort in having like little incentives like this, and everyone likes bookish candles, so I was really excited about that. So according to the packaging, this smells like freshly printed pages and unlimited possibilities, which that's just super cute. This is probably another candle that after I'm done burning it, I'll probably hold on to the tin because it's adorable. So it would be cool if maybe they offered a couple different scents if they're just doing the candles route, or offer just like a couple different things. I don't know. I feel like we'll maybe see that be expanded even more next year, because I have noticed in the past couple of months, Book of the Month has been marketed everywhere. Like I keep getting ads for it, even on like Hulu when I'm watching non-bookish content. Like I used to maybe get an ad once in a blue moon when I was watching BookTube, but now I'll just be watching like Lost or something on Hulu and I'll get an ad for Book of the Month. So that being said, the smell is not my favorite. Definitely not turning my nose up at a free candle. I do think it is very cute looking, and I do love how it says it smells like freshly printed pages and unlimited possibilities. That's really cute. Now for my books, I got 3 again. I can't remember a month that I haven't gotten 3. Or at least 2. It's bad. There was honestly a point at the beginning of this year where I was not vibing with any of Book of the Month's picks. I think it started like December of last year to like March. I was either skipping or getting one book a month, and I was considering maybe quitting at the end of this year. But then I just feel like for a lot of reasons, they had to sit down and think about their company and really expand what they wanted to do. I think they really expanded the amount of genres that they offer each month, the different stories that are being told, and like the authors that are being offered each month as well. So I don't know like what precise new mission statements they must have, but I just feel like the whole service has gotten a total rehaul this year for the better. So I'm really excited to see the next year to come and see just like what new things they have in store for us, as well as the picks, because they've just been killing it recently. So I'm gonna go with the most random book that I picked first, because I actually hadn't heard about this until Book of the Month offered it, and then I keep seeing it in different literary circles. Like, I believe this book is Barnes & Noble's book club pick of the month, and that is Leave the World Behind by Rumen Alam, and this is, I believe, a thriller. Every synopsis, I keep getting a little bit different of a vibe from this book, so I'm really intrigued. First of all, not that it matters, but I think the cover design of this is really stunning and eye-catching, and I think it does a really good job of displaying kind of the tone and the themes of this book, potentially. But Leave the World Behind is about a family who lives in New York, and they get like an Airbnb or like rent-a-cabin situation where they go to this cabin in the middle of nowhere to spend a nice, relaxing, unplugged week, I believe, from the hustle and bustle of their normal lives. Everything is going fine, they're having a really nice relaxing vacation, until the cabin's owners show up, and the cabin's owners are an older couple, and they come with some really terrifying news. They're saying there is like a blackout in New York, or I believe further than that, but the phones aren't working, TVs aren't working, a lot of like electrical technology, things like that aren't working, and there's something really bad going on, almost like the start of an apocalypse sort of deal. And this family has been isolated already, so they don't really know, first of all, if this couple is actually the owners of this cabin, or if these things are actually happening. So it's like a psychological thriller, and these two families thrown together in this cabin trying to figure out what's going on, if anything's going on in the world, and figuring out just how much to trust the other parties in this situation. So it sounds very wild, and I have heard that this book does kind of have a lot of themes that are relevant to everything that's happening this year, which is crazy. I feel like there are so many books like that that are like super relevant to what's going on this year that were written obviously before this year. So I'm very intrigued to read more about this one. Honestly, just with like the vibes of the cover, it's really screaming like November to me. So I'm probably going to pick it up then, because I have a very slammed TBR for October, but I am really excited to pick it up. The next book that I have to talk about is A Deadly Education by Naomi Novak. This is the first book in the Scholomance series, which is about a girl named Elle. I believe. This series is about a deadly school where people with magical abilities come to train at, and the main character has some super dark, terrifying power that's very villain-coded, and people are scared of her because of that. So she's fighting against that perception of her. It just seems like a very dark academia book with magic set in a magic school, and I've been looking for books like that, so I'm very excited to pick this one up. It's the first book in a new series. I've heard wonderful things about the series, and I have read from Naomi Novak before. I actually haven't read Uprooted or Spinning Silver, but I have read from the Temeraire series, and I really enjoyed that, so I'm excited to pick this up. It has a lot of tropes, which I absolutely love, and I just have a feeling this is going to be a series that I'm going to really enjoy. This is another one where I instantly want to, after I'm done filming this, sit down and start reading it, but I do want to finish a couple of series that I'm in the middle of before I get to this one. So again, probably November, maybe even December for this one, but I am really looking forward to picking it up. And then the next book I got, can you guess? Can you guess? Because everyone, I feel like everyone is talking about this book, no matter whether you are fans of the author for a long time or if this is your first book, like me, for this author. I just feel like everyone is really intrigued with this book, and that is going to be The Invisible Life of Addie LaRue by V.E. Schwab. First of all, I love this cover design, what Book of the Month did for it. I don't know if you can tell, but the text as well as the Book of the Month logo and the one on the side is gold foiled, which is really awesome. And it even has some marketing on the back as well, which Book of the Month books don't really tend to do. They tend to just be blank on the back. So I am going to be reading this one this month, and I'm just super excited about it. I don't want to give a big synopsis because I feel like everyone is talking about this slash knows what it is about, but it is about a young woman who is in the 1700s France, I believe, maybe. And surprise, surprise, life for women back then, not so great. She basically doesn't want to be a property piece. She doesn't want to be sold off into another family where all she has to do in life is just kind of have kids and be her husband's property. So she actually makes a deal with a devil that she will get her agency, get her freedom, and get a mortal life. But there are some caveats to this that she discovers throughout her century country's long life. So I'm very excited to read that one as well. So yeah, that was my not so quick unboxing of all of the bookish things that I got at the beginning of this month. Comment down below if you want a dedicated reading vlog for any of those books I talked about. I'm thinking about having one for either Scholomance or The Invisible Life of Addie of LaRue, whichever one I feel like would make a good contained vlog. I've been in a really good reading mood, which I really wasn't in September. I read some books that put me in a reading slump. Cough, cough, House of Leaves. It was really bad, unfortunately, but I have read really good books this month. So I read The Damned by Renée Audier. That is the sequel to The Beautiful. I did enjoy that one. That one was a really fantastic audiobook. And then I also read Night of the Mannequins by Stephen Graham Jones. That's one of the best novellas that I've read in a really long time. And if you're looking for like a slasher story that is very fast paced and you can read in one sitting, I do highly recommend that one. Currently, I'm in the middle of Sarah J. Maas's Queen of Shadows, and I'm almost to the 200 page mark. However, I'm mostly reading this one like right when I go to bed, just because this is, I don't want to say a light and fluffy read, because this is definitely getting darker as the series goes on. But for me, this book is a really perfect book to unwind to because it is a high fantasy, but it is a very slower paced high fantasy. I feel like I can get away with just reading a couple of pages before bed and not feeling like I have to binge the entire book in one sitting. And then I'm also probably going to pick up another book as well. I'm participating in the Trick or Readathon, so I'll probably try and read another book. So I already did two of those prompts, Vampire and Werewolf. That was The Damned and Night of the Mannequins respectively. So I might pick up an audiobook just to have an audiobook and a physical book going at the same time. So I'm thinking of either The Witching Hour by Anne Rice, or maybe We Sold Our Souls by Grady Hendrix, one of those. But I have definitely been talking long enough for this update, so I am going to go try and do something a little bit productive, and I will check back in with you guys later. So it is now Wednesday, and I don't have like any in-depth reading updates for you guys today. I've managed to pick two very long books to read this week. So I don't anticipate me finishing any books until the end of the week, but we'll see. I'm currently reading Queen of Shadows, and I am almost to page 300 on that one. And let me just say, for this one, I hear people all the time say that they hate Kale. They don't like Kale. Kale is one of the worst characters. They're not a fan of him. He just doesn't seem to be like a very popular character. And I knew that going into this series. And up until this point in Queen of Shadows, I had not really seen why he consistently gets so much hate. I mean, he was definitely not my favorite character by any means in any of the books, but I understood his motivations, I understood why he did things, and I did appreciate his more reserved rebellion style, just because a lot of characters in this series are very, very impulsive. I definitely think that in any group of people, we do need a couple people to kind of check that and pull some people back a little bit. So he's never been my favorite, but I understand why he was there, and he never actually bothered me at all until this book. From the very first time he's introduced, he just irritates me in every single scene. I feel like even at the end of the last book, we were maybe seeing him get some character development and kind of realize why other people feel so strongly about things, because he's very much a character where he doesn't want to break the law because that's bad, even if the laws are terrible in the first place. And I mean, he's a kid. Most of the main characters in here are 16, 17 to start, 18, 19, 20. So they're young, definitely understand why he has a little ways to go in learning about what makes a good ruler, what a king should be doing for his subjects. And I thought he was kind of turning around by the end of the last book, Air of Fire. And then we get to this book and he's just being so combative towards everyone and for no reason. Like, I just want to kind of shake a lot of characters in here and be like, you guys are literally all on the same side. But he's just so petty, and not even petty, he's more like vindictive in the ways that he is disagreeing with other rebels, that he doesn't agree with the ends justifying the means, and he's just kind of a jerk. So I get it. And kind of sounds like, from everyone's reaction towards his character, he doesn't get better. So that makes me a lot bit nervous to read Tower of Dawn, because apparently that's from his perspective for the most part, and just his perspective. But a wild thing I actually learned yesterday, I was reading this, it's very, very chunky. It's like 600 pages. Doesn't bother me, I love chunky books. But I was noticing the next book in the series, which is Empire of Storms right here, is significantly smaller. So I was looking at the sizes between these two, and this is the next book that I have to read. It was very jarring seeing how different that this book was to this one in terms of size. And it made me like worry a little bit that this might be a filler book. But then I actually went to see the page count and see how different they were. And they're like the same amount of pages. This just has super thin Bible-y pages, and this one has thicker pages. So I think there's only like a 20 page difference between these two, which is crazy because they look a lot different in size. But other than that, I am really enjoying this read so far. I'm hoping to finish the series by the end of the year. So as long as I finish that book this month, then I should be on track to do that. Kind of, I'll just need to double up one month. And I don't think it's gonna be this one where I double up. And then at work today, I picked up a new audiobook, and that is The Witching Hour by Anne Rice. The audiobook is literally 50 hours long. So I really was not expecting that. But you know, I've just recently finished The Damned, and I am kind of craving that same sort of atmosphere. So this doesn't have vampires in it, I don't think, but it is about witches who live in New Orleans. And I'm just gonna say right now, I definitely haven't even cracked into this book too much yet, because I am only, listen to how demoralizing this is. I'm only 7% of the way through the book, which doesn't sound like a lot, but I've already listened to nearly 4 hours. I mean, the math makes sense, but it doesn't mean that I have to like it, because I just feel discouraged by that number, and I know it shouldn't matter, but when you're listening to something for such a long time and see that you're not even 10% of the way through the book, you know it's gonna be a long one. So I will say, almost 4 hours in, you are not going to like this book if you despise info dumps, if you don't like long descriptions of things, or if you don't like slow books, because essentially the past 4 hours of this book, the first hour and a half of this is introducing one character, and it's not info dumpy, but it is very descriptive in like a very Stephen King-esque way, where he just starts describing everything, even things where I don't really think that they're needed, but it's just like setting up an atmosphere. It was starting off very slow, and then the last couple of hours have been introducing another character, and it literally starts at one point in his life, and this man is almost 50, and then from that event, it goes back to when he's like 6 years old and goes through all of the important events in his life leading up to that point. So it is very info dumpy because it is essentially a micro history on this one man. Here's the thing, for me, because I was listening to the audiobook and I was also doing something else while I was listening to it, it actually wasn't too dull, surprisingly. Yes, though, it is a huge info dump because it is literally going through all of like the watershed moments of this one man's life. And I do think it's going to be very important, and it's like showing all of the events that made him who he is. And I do think it's all going to be relevant to the plot. I just thought it was so strange because usually you'll get flashback scenes like that interspersed right before they're about to become relevant. Anne Rice just said, no, I don't think so. You're getting this man's whole life story at the beginning of this book. And there haven't been any witches yet. So it's definitely going to be a very slow read. I think that's pretty typical of Anne Rice. I've read Interview with a Vampire twice now, And the first time I read it was a very long time ago. The second time I read it was more recently. I think it was in 2018 or early 2019. And from what I remember of it, that one was very slow moving as well. This, I want to say, feels longer and slower than that one. But again, I couldn't tell you if that's just how I'm feeling or if that's how it actually is, because I did watch the movie Interview with a Vampire before I read the book. So I think knowing what events are to come kind of speeds up the process because you're anticipating things, something mental like that. I would have to check to see comparatively how long both of these books are, but this one feels very slow. So it's definitely not going to be a book for everyone. I don't mind. I don't think if I were to check this out from the library or like pick up a physical copy of this book and read it, I don't think I would be having as good of a time as I am. And I am really enjoying it because the writing is really good. It's very strong. And I have no complaints about the substance in it so far, other than the fact that I definitely think that I probably would have gotten more annoyed with it if I weren't listening to it while doing other things. So I'm very intrigued to see how that one is going to play out as I listen to more of it. But that's really all I have for you guys in terms of updates so far. So I will check back in with you guys either a little bit later today or probably tomorrow. So I finished Queen of Shadows last night, and I have lots of thoughts about this one. I feel like both Heir of Fire and Queen of Shadows now, the first 100 or so pages are definitely not the most gripping, and I don't mean that in a negative way. A lot of very large epic fantasy books, especially when you get into the tomes, tend to kind of start out pretty slow. There's a lot of slower moments in between faster paced moments, so that's fine. And I didn't really mind it, but it is something to note because I do feel like the first two books in the series, Throne of Glass and Crown of Midnight, are both very fast paced, more of like a YA sort of feel, where Heir of Fire and then Queen of Shadows have started to be still YA, I would say, but definitely leaning more towards adult. And therefore, the pacing has been very, very different. So for this one, I'd say the first 100, almost maybe a first 200 pages, I was enjoying this. I wasn't not enjoying it, but it was very slow. It took me a while to become really invested, and again, not that I wasn't enjoying it, but I could definitely read maybe a chapter or two before bed and then be done with it. But then you hit somewhere around like the almost close to midpoint mark, and then it really starts picking up. The action starts picking up. You kind of see what the stakes are going to be in the individual books. And I quite enjoyed this one. The ending in particular, I felt was really strong, and I feel like is really showcasing the bigger stakes that are going to be happening in the next couple of books and really escalating the conflict from smaller conflicts to more of a large grand scale conflict. I'm not going to get too spoilery just because this isn't a dedicated reading vlog for this book, but I might go a little bit deeper into just certain things in here. So if you really want to go into this blind, if you haven't read it already, you can go ahead and skip past when I'm holding this book up. This, like a lot of fantasy books, have a lot of different point of views, and some of them were a lot more engaging than others. I really hated Kale in this book. I understand, I get why his character's doing the things that he's doing, kind of, but that doesn't mean I have to like it. He really annoyed me. Honestly, thinking about this book, I'm not really a fan of any of the male characters. Aelin was okay. She did spend the majority of this book kind of still focusing on some internal struggles rather than external struggles. And as someone who generally doesn't really like the paranormal sort of aspect of a centuries old guy falling in love with a barely out of her teens woman. I understand in fantasy romances it's a very common trope, so I do like try and suspend my disbelief for that world is a different world than our world, but I'm just like not a big fan of Aelin and Rowan yet as a couple. I think the power dynamic with him being centuries old and her being 19 is just kind of weird and kind of predatory. Even though she's the one kind of pursuing it, he's kind of holding back on it. I feel like something's going to have to change with her status as like a human before that relationship would really sit right with me, because it's strange. But I really enjoyed Manon's point of view. That's really cool. Lysandra as a character really was awesome. This book really has me hoping for the rest of the series for Aelin to get more female friends, because I think her female friendships are absolutely wonderful. The way Lysandra like kind of leaves off in this book kind of makes me think that she's not really going to be as big of a heavy hitter in the next couple of books. I hope I'm wrong, because I really loved her character. I thought that was really excellently done, as well as Ilde and just the 13 and Manon. I thought all of those dynamics, those female friendship dynamics, were really awesome. So overall, I did really highly enjoy this, and I'm looking forward to reading the next installation in the series, probably in November, honestly. But every single time that I finish one of these, I do definitely want to pick up the next one, because while the last two have kind of started out really slow, by the end of it, Sarah J. Maas is really good at endings, so it really makes you want to pick up the next book and see where the story is going from here. I did read that for a prompt for the Trick or Readathon, and I read that for the prompt Demon, which is read a book that has more than one point of view. That means I am three prompts down. I'm still working my way through The Witching Hour by Anne Rice. I mean, that's a lengthy book, so I'm not going to have a full finished reading update for that one for a while. I did pick up We Sold Our Souls by Grady Hendrix as an audiobook. I have not gotten far into that one at all, but I am really excited to be picking it up, and I am hoping to be reading more of that sometime today. So I will check back in with you guys tomorrow. So clearly by the hair change, it has been a little bit since my last update. So this is like kind of a weekly vlog and more of like a vlog compilation of the past 2 weeks, but I am gonna go ahead and wrap it up here. Books that I read during this time, I already talked about Queen of Shadows in length. And while I am in the process of several other books, I haven't finished any, mainly just because I've been rewatching Criminal Minds, and that is just such a time suck, but in like the best possible way. I absolutely love that show. I always forget how much I love that show until I rewatch it, and then it's just perfection. So that's definitely been taking away from reading time, but I did start a couple of other books. I don't really have anything more to say about The Witching Hour by Anne Rice. Still chug along through that. It's good writing. It's very slow. I don't have much more to say about that, but I did start, and I do anticipate on finishing today, We Sold Our Souls by Grady Hendrix. And I am really enjoying this one a lot more than I was like nervous that I would. And just the most succinct way that I can put it, it wasn't that I thought it was going to be a bad book or anything, but I definitely knew if a random author had written that book and I hadn't read anything from the author before, I probably like wouldn't pick it up, or I might pick it up if it fit to like a reading challenge prompt, or if it was a buddy read, something like that. But I never would go out of my way to seek out a book with that synopsis. But just because it is Grady Hendrix and I love his work, I wanted to read this one, and I am really glad. He definitely has his fun little Grady Hendrix spin on tropes that can definitely be overplayed in horror fiction, so that's really exciting. As you can probably guess from the title, this does deal with selling souls and making Faustian bargains to succeed in life and get what you want. So we're following our main protagonist, Chris, and when she was younger, she was in a heavy metal band with a group of her childhood friends. They were right on the cusp of making it big, and then something terrible happens and the band really dissolves and everyone goes their own separate ways. Fast forward, I think like a decade or so, everyone in the band has pretty much not really lived up to their potential, especially Chris. She just feels like she's kind of at a dead-end job. She's still living at her parents' house. She definitely feels like she hasn't lived up to that potential of potentially becoming a star. And this is true for every other person in the band except for the frontrunner Terry, who is now pretty much one of the biggest stars of all time. Some creepy conspiratorial things start happening, and Chris starts to maybe realize that the reason why Terry became so successful and the rest of them have not become successful in anything, including non-music related careers, might be something a little bit darker than luck. So I am really enjoying this. I think I have about an hour and a half left more of the audiobook. So I would say for me, My Best Friend's Exorcism is my favorite Grady Hendrix book, followed very closely by Southern Book Club's Guide to Slaying Vampires. Those feel very similar to me, just in terms of writing style and plot structure and just the way things are happening. Now, this one, honestly, like the pacing and the plot, although it couldn't be more different, it feels a lot more like Horror Store, which I think is really interesting. And if you've read all of Grady Hendrix's work, leave a comment down below, let me know, because I definitely think that they're kind of two separate, they're not two separate writing styles, because you can definitely tell Grady Hendrix wrote all of them, and they're all really good, really solid books, but I just think that Southern Book Club's Guide and My Best Friend's Exorcism have a bit of a different feel than Horror Store or We Sold Our Souls, so I'd be interested to see if maybe how people's rankings are depending on which of the two of the four books they like better. I think that would be really neat to see, because I definitely am seeing more similarities to Horror Store in this one, just because I feel like the main characters are in really similar situations. They're very unlikable, but in a way where you still are excited to read about and want to see them succeed, and just the plot beats and the pacing are very similar. So I am really enjoying it. I'm glad I finally picked it up. I will say I don't really enjoy the audiobook, and this is no slight to the narrator, and I still have been listening to it off and on. It's just that there's something about the narrator's voice, and I think it's just like the tone and the pitch of it. It's really hard to listen to, like when I'm in my car or when I'm listening to it with headphones in. So if I just have my phone and I'm listening at home, it's totally fine, but I actually have problems like with the actual sound quality and being able to hear everything, especially when I'm in my car. So not the best audiobook, and I really wish it would be like more full cast. And there are several kind of asides where you're listening to different radio stations in between chapters of the book. I think that would be so cool to have that, like a little more sound effects and voice actors in there. So I probably would recommend you go the physical book route for this one, but I am really enjoying it. So that is going to be the end of this reading vlog. If you liked it, be sure to give it a like, leave a comment down below, subscribe for more content from me. Stay safe, stay spooky, and I will catch you in my next video. Bye!